brothers on the rise now. Woo! Endless celebrations all in my house. Yeah. Levitating now, I'm super duper fly now. Yeah. London boy, but they see where I reside now. Put the time in while you always yelling time out. F the critic, cause I know I'm coming with it. You were sitting, you were wishing I was handling my business. Yeah. Now I got the ball like Harry Potter playing Quidditch. And my business is humongous, you a thing that happens in it. Damn, man, I'm all that, yeah, I'm all that. Looking for that whip, yeah, that what you call that. Me where they at though. They at, I'm though. The new pop, all I do is rap though. Yeah. Want me on your song, throw a couple stacks, yo. Woo. Everybody wanna do the same thing. Yup. That's why we ain't on the same page. No. Do my own thing and I maintain. Woo. Flow like water, so I'm going mainstream. I'm going mainstream. Flow like water, so I'm going mainstream. Yeah, I'm going mainstream. Flow like water, so I'm going mainstream. I'm going mainstream. Mainstream. Flow like water, so I'm going mainstream. Yup.
PlayStation 5 was nearly impossible to come by.
Hunting for a new PlayStation for Christmas or an Xbox Series 10? Good luck.
That guy's here with a big announcement. Microsoft is proud to bring a new console. But wait a minute, listen close to the words I say. They swear it's Nintendo. It's an Xbox. No, we told you before, it's an Xbox, yeah. But what's the name? Xbox right Series 10, I'll say it again, Xbox Series 10, we suck again, now it's called as real, we the big announcement. Microsoft is proud to bring a new console, but wait a minute, listen close to the words I say, swear, Xbox Series 10, I'll say it again, Xbox Series 10, we suck again now. Now it's called with us. We're number 4 or 5, hey, don't you know? Yeah, the big boys put on the show, yeah. Xbox Series 10, no one a name, can't you tell? We're playing the failed game, game on. But we suck again, what a surprise. Here we go, competing with the big boys, put on a show. Xbox Series 10, no one a name, can't you tell? We're playing the failed game, game on. Oh, we suck again, what a surprise. Here we go, confusing our customers, oh, what a ride, what a ride. Xbox Series S, also known as Booster. Who needs clarity? We'll just make it looser. Pretend I got a tale to tell about a little console that didn't do so well. Trying to play it cool with no exclusive games, but ended up confusing fans. What a shame. Xbox Series 10, or is it Xbox Series X? Man, I can't keep up with these name tricks. One day it's Project Scarlet, the next it's Series X. Come on, Microsoft, what the heck? Oh, we suck again, can't even get our name right. Losing fans, causing a console fight. Xbox, Xbox, you're playing with my brain. Can't we just stick to a name for crying out loud? What are we doing?
They just Xbox said I feel the rhythm in the air. Everybody's moving like they just don't care. Shaking it up, breaking it down, we're on fire. Come on and join it, it's a party you desire. Dance till the beat, I feel spent. Come on, let's go. Feel the music pulsing.
Xbox tears, we're playing with your hearts. In this Xbox city where the magic fails, we're caught up in the bullshit, the lack of our game sales. Feel the beat of Phil Spencer, come on, let's go. Feel the music pulsing through your soul.
Yo, what's up, Grinders? How you doing? It's a late night grind. Maybe I should be whispering. It's late out here. It's a late night grindhouse. That's right. Play it loud, baby. Play it loud. We jamming. This is the nightclub. What's up, everybody? How you doing? How's everybody doing? Yes, a surprise stream. But you know what? I wanted to go over a couple of things. Now I feel a little bit better. Still hanging on, a little bit under the weather. Still hanging in there, but I feel a lot better than I felt on Monday. But yeah, I wanted to get another, you know, just some reaction. I had so much stuff, and in doing the videos and things like that, I've been finding some old videos and some old speeches. And like I said, is Phil watching tonight? Oh my goodness, we got Phil here. Shout out to everybody coming on in here. El Nini, first one in here. What's up, Liquid Data? How you doing, man? Therapy, Quantified Data, Ward, Joe Rowe, Michael Meridian, Diablo, Doc Matt, Leech. Michael, yo, what's up, man? How you doing? BV, Primal Plasma, how you doing? Robert Lawrence, what's up? How you doing? Hit that like button, everybody, as you're coming on in here. Let them know that the Grindhouse lights are on, and this is a late-night Grindhouse. I know a lot of people, we don't do that, you know, the late-night Grindhouse too much. But, yeah, I have a lot to kind of cover. I wanted to react kind of to a couple of videos that I've been going around and watching. And it's so interesting because, you know, I've been, grabbing content and videos and trying to put some music videos together and you know, just watching some things just show up on my feed and going through them. And I thought, I was like, you know what, why don't I go, what's up, Jeremiah? Yep, up late, man. Yeah, hopefully you guys gaming, playing, and listening to the Grindhouse. We're gonna be going over a few videos that I happened to just see, and you may have seen them before, but it's just so interesting. What's up, Tools? We got the Tools here. We good now. We got Tools. Tools showed up. What's up, Tools, man? How you doing? He's always been here. We had the Tools day one. We didn't need any of that junk waiting for Tools and all that other stuff. Well, let me tell you something. So I thought we'd react to some videos and things because you know how going through what we know now and the state that we're in right now compared to how we got here. And I just remember all the different rhetorics and things of how fear-mongering and this, and don't take it that way. That's not what he meant. What's up, Lucci? How you doing, man? What's up, Damasi? You know, that's not what he meant. What he meant was, and what they meant was, oh, this is what they're doing. Everybody's doing it. We're all doing it. And just listening to every single step of the way and hearing that and seeing where we are now on this kind of cusp of uncertainty still after pivots upon pivots, after $80 billion later of acquisitions and court documents and legals and all this stuff, like all those guys, the Lulus, the Floridians, the Hose Law, like all this stuff that was relevant last year because it was all about the Activision battle. And 6 months into this thing, dude, what's up, Big Razzo? 6 months into this thing, there's been nothing. You wouldn't even thought they spent that amount of money. The only thing that seems to have caught up with them was the amount of money that they spent. That's what's crazy. It seems that now is the revelation that's causing them to go down this path that they're in. But, you know, I have the Phil quotes and things like that from previous, how he didn't want to lose the console war and the console space and, you know, they need to still be there and it's still important and all these things. And then to see how now it's not about that. It's about this. He's playing with the console like he used to play with exclusives, how they used to matter. Then they don't matter. Now we buy them and we make them matter. And now we buy places. But we'll keep the original ideas, you know, the original games. We'll keep them where they are. We're not going to take away, but we're going to, you know, do more and we're going to tell them to stop making games. Oh, we're not doing that. And all this back and forth of what Starfield going to be exclusive, not exclusive, all this, everything. But we go even further back, how they hyped up power and what the capabilities of the machine was. And go back to that. And then go back and talk about the games that were coming out. Just a few videos, man, that really, really are just eye-opening, head shakers, just face palm, and hilarious in the same thing. Detrimentally hilarious just watching this stuff. And I thought, let's watch it all together at a late night grindhouse theater. Let's do that together and let's go back. Because I listened to some of them, I'm like, oh no, this is good. I need to do this with the grindhouse. What's up, Thrifty? How you doing, man? I was trying to wait till Thrifty show was over, making sure that, you know, I didn't want to kind of, you know, stomp on, do my thing with Thrifty, because I know Thrifty was live, but I definitely wanted to get this out before it's too late. But thanks, Thrifty, for coming through, man. If you missed Thrifty's show, go definitely check it out. But yeah, I was like, you know what? Oh, man, this is too good. I got to watch this with the Grindhouse. I'm like, we need to watch this. We need Grindhouse boards. We need some music. Let's do a late night after party, like late night theater, and watch some of these things because they are head scratches. So, and I have a few of them. I'm probably not going to do all of them because it is late. But there are a couple. First, I like to just go back and talk this. Like, we're going to go back to the OG Xbox. We're going to go back to why the Xbox console exists from a company of Microsoft. That, why would a company that makes PCs or makes an operating system want to get into the gaming industry? What was the whole reason why? What's up, Mr. Tennis? And shout out to everybody, you know, coming on in here. Hit that like button. We're going to go back there. Shout out to the VIP grinders coming on in here. I see you guys. You're burning the midnight oil here. The VIPs coming on in. Just want to shout out to you guys on the VIPs. We're growing there. That is over 130 members. I think we need another up to 150 to get the new emoji coming in there. So we're just at, and I got an update now this week, the Golden Grinders and Platinum Grinders. And then also our Ultimate Grinders. We have added another few members of that. We also have, I have to add them as well. We have another three members into there. So we're really growing that Ultimate Grinders, that Grinds Pass. You like the music. And drop some new music today. There was one yesterday for the VIPs and Ultimate Grinders. And then we also have we have some Ultimate Grinders, Grinds Pass, as we call it here, that you could listen to the songs the day they come out and you have access to all the songs. So we have a bunch of members in there for the Ultimate Grinders. Shout out to you guys. You could upgrade if you're a VIP to get those songs as they dropped. I've dropped a new one today. Man, I know this is a hit. This one's a hit. I've been jamming to this song that when I make them and I hear them, and I'm like, yo, this is, that worked. And then it did with the video, that Stella Blade one. Oh, man. And by the way, I played Stellar Blade demo for about a few hours already. That game is insane. That game is awesome. It looks incredible. The music is great. What's up, Eric? How you doing, man? The music is great. The combat is good. Now, before we go back into Xbox history, the music, I'll talk more about it on Friday. But, man, the music is incredible. The combat is great. It is challenging. And it is so good. It's challenging and deep, and it's not just like a Devil May Cry, just slash, 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 slash. Like, it is strategic, and it has quality usance, quality splits. And everybody's talking about the character and the curves and all the. You want to know what? I'm going to tell you something right now.
Stop! Enough!
Stop it! There are amazing looking women in that move in that game. All right. That's what it is. That is the artist's vision. You know, if they could draw some goddamn Halo rat and it looks like a piece of shit, that's the Halo vision. That is their vision. This is the artist's vision. This is what they want the characters to look like. Yo, I'm down for it. It's incredible. It's so good. It's great. It's a visual style and just, and again, it is so well done. I just think it's incredible. Like the enemy designs, the combat. From what I played, man, this is the next hit, definitely. And it inspired me to make a song about it. So that song, the Stellar Blade, yo, when that gets released, oh my goodness. The VIP, the Ultimate Grinders are loving it right now.
But man, when that, when, you know, if they vote that one in for you guys to listen to, that is going to be the next anthem for that game. Cause that is that song. I'm loving it. I've been jamming to that song a lot, but, yeah, Dead or Alive, dude, come on. What about, you know, listen, it's after dark. So we're going to talk a little after dark. Yeah. Yo, I remember Cyberpunk. Oh, you could adjust the penis size and you could adjust the size. Oh, my goodness. And they made such a big deal. Oh, the genitals. You could do all. You know what? It was stupid. They made a big deal about it. I say it wasn't long enough. Pause. Oh, yeah. It wasn't long enough. I was like, that's it? It only went to 1 to 5. I'm like, yo, 1 to 10. Where's 10? Can't make it big enough. What's going on here? Had a comment to the devs. The hell's this? You made such a big deal about I could make the size of the thing on Cyberpunk. You only gave me 5 levels. I was looking for level 10. What's going on here? Pause. Shit, what the hell are we doing here? The hell's going on here? It's Late Night Grindhouse. Hit that like button. What are we doing here? 5 levels. Jeremiah, remember? Oh, you can make them this. You can make them this. And when I got in there, that was the first thing I did. I was like, oh, they made such a big deal about it. Let me see how long I can make it. And that was it. I wanted that thing down to my knees and be walking. I wanted to use it as a weapon. I thought that's how big a deal they're making such a big deal about it. I thought I could go around swinging it around in bars. Knocking over all the stuff on the bar. That's what I thought. Yeah, why is 2 feet not an option? That's right, BV. Hell out. I was looking for level 10. I thought I could use it as another weapon. Be walking into the bars going, yo, what? You got something to say? Right, what? I hit my slap. I go like this. What? You got what? I walk into the bar in Cyberpunk. I got a level 10 here. I'm walking around. No weapons. I don't got any weapons. Somebody gives me trouble. I'm like, what? What did you say? What did you say? Oh, I slap you with it.
I'm here to tell you right now. We don't care.
I know. They didn't care about the size. But they made such a big deal. That's all I heard about Cyberpunk. Then what happens? The bugs. Now we're talking about Eve and all this other stuff. You know what? Grow a pair, please. It's not for the kids. Exactly. It beats Stick, Big Razzo. Big Razzo. The reason, as much as they talked about that what you can do in Cyberpunk. Exactly, Robert Lawrence. The way they talked about it, I thought this thing was going to be a big deal. It went to 1 to 5. I was like, oh, you can make it a little bull. Well, make that's it. I'm like, well, what's the big deal here? The big deal. Now they make it. Please go play Stellblade. It's freaking all credible. Stop with the people that are worrying about what she looks like, what the characters look. Please. I just played the game. Game was great. Gameplay, enemy design, music, atmosphere, graphics from the demo. Incredible. Next hit. Telling you. And it has a little bit of that challenge to it. It's not just run around, just hit square. But anyway, I'm divulging. Anyway, I got sidetracked with a Stellblade demo. But that song is awesome. So, Ultimate Grinders, you enjoying it? I got more songs coming your way. All ready to go. So, Ultimate Grinders, Grinds Pass, enjoy. So, I figured we go back. Let's go back into what the video is about. Let's react to some videos here after the Stellblade discussion, which there'll be definitely more, I am sure. But now, let's go. Why was the Xbox created? Was it because Bill Gates liked gaming? Was it because Steve Ballmer thought that we needed something to play against Nintendo? Why was the Xbox created? For what? Yo, shout out to Michael Marini at the 5 VIP Grinders! Awesome. There you go. Big Razzle, Nat, you can listen to the brand new song for the VIPs. They got a special song yesterday. So everybody that just got a VIP today, you got a song accessible just to the VIPs and to the Ultimate Grinders. So just to let you know, Boyskies, Nassim, Big Razzo, Steve J, Sam Alton, thank you so much, Michael Meridian. You guys can listen to the brand new song that just got released yesterday for the VIPs and the grinders. It's called Xbox Sign Here. So probably play that at the end, but you got access to that now. So all the VIPs. Yeah, Bill Gates didn't want an Xbox, Big Razzle. Exactly. Yeah, I'm up late, man. We're wilding. We're wilding tonight, man. To cause a disturbance in the fort. And you know what? Let's see what it, let's start our reactions. Let's go. Let's without further ado. Let's go back. Here he is, Seamus Blackley. Why was the Xbox created? Was it to play Kumbaya with everybody? What was the reason why? Was it to play Nintendo games? Was it to because Bill Gates can't wait to play a video game? Let's see.
First of all, let's talk about who you are and what your role was in the founding of Xbox.
Well, hey, it's nice to be here. It's super great to have an opportunity to talk about this thing. So Xbox was actually an idea that was a response to some Sony PR that I read right before getting on a flight to Boston. And by the time I came back to Redmond, I had this whole presentation about how we should take the graphics technology I was working on for Windows and make a specific, you know, set PC whose specs wouldn't change so we could compete with the PlayStation. And the next thing you knew, okay, it was a game console.
Holy Spirit, activate.
Oh, no.
Holy Spirit, no. Activate. Oh, no. Holy Spirit, activate. Activate. Activate.
Good morning, good evening, Billy. I don't know what to say. It's 4 a.m. Hey, enjoy the grindhouse late at night. Dude, that can't make you go to sleep right there. It was for gaming. It was to bring great games to more players, to make games for gamers. Michael Meridian upgrades in Ultimate VIP. Michael Meridian got all the music. Grinds pass. There it is, Michael Meridian. Shout out to you, man. Enjoy the songs. Let me know in the comments. You guys that hear them day one, all the songs, let me know if you like them and any suggestions. Late Night Grinds. Listen, there you go. It was to make games, for gamers to have fun. Was it to entertain you? Was it to entertain me? Is that what he said? Xbox was created to entertain us? It was an entertainment device? It was a response to Sony PR. To build a set piece of fixed hardware with their PC DirectX of fixed hardware to compete against PlayStation. Kumbaya my ass.
One of the original leaders of the Xbox.
I could actually.
It's nice to be here. Super great to have an opportunity to talk about this thing. So Xbox was actually an idea that was a response to some Sony PR that I read right before getting on a flight to Boston. And by the time I came back to Redmond, I had this whole presentation about how we should take the graphics technology I was working on for Windows and make a specific, you know, set PC whose specs wouldn't change so we could compete with the PlayStation. And the next thing you knew, it was a game console.
And
you know what that Sony PR was? You know what that Sony PR was? That Sony PR was that they were building a PC for your living room. They wanted to go into the living room, and a gaming console was a type of gaming device, a PC-esque type device, and goes into your living room. It was a PC, quote-unquote, for your living room. And that was the PR, where he came back and was like, yo, let's make our own. They're going to own the living room. We're in the offices. We need to get in the living room. Really? So it wasn't about games at all. It wasn't about entertaining anybody. You know, what's funny is that the Sony PlayStation was making games for people. I'm sure they had business reasons, but Microsoft's response was because Sony was a threat to them in the living room. They made it to, he said it right there. It was created.
Technology I was working on for Windows and make a specific, you know, set PC whose specs wouldn't change so we could compete with the PlayStation.
Built to compete with the PlayStation. The Xbox created was a response to the existence of the PlayStation.
Hold on.
Okay.
Holy Spirit, activate.
Oh, no.
Holy Spirit, no. Activate. Holy Spirit, activate. Activate.
Xbox even activate. Buddied up with Sega, who was escorted out of the gaming space because of PlayStation. So they had a lot of animosity towards PlayStation, and Xbox kind of gravitated and pulled some of that with Sega, and that's where Peter Moore came from. That's why he had a little edge to him, because he wanted to stick it to Sony, because Sony hurt his beloved brand of Sega. This is the creation of Xbox. It was a response to compete with the PlayStation. The existence of this. This wasn't like Microsoft wanted to entertain people. It was a response. So, hearing that as a PlayStation and as creation of a PlayStation, you're like, oh, Xbox wants to be our friend? Like, that thing was created to drive us out of business or to compete with us. It was a response to us. It wasn't a response that Microsoft had something extra to offer gaming. No. And Sony got into it because they were trying to get partnered with Nintendo to get into gaming, and Nintendo screwed them with Philips. And Sony was left with the CD technology and said, well, we're just going to make our own gaming console then if Nintendo doesn't want to work with us, after Sony decided to go with Philips instead of Sony. And Nintendo went with Philips instead of Sony, and that's how Sony got into the business. Because they were working on it, and Nintendo pulled an okie-dokie on them. Now, Microsoft created a direct Xbox to compete against the PlayStation. Think about that, and think about where we are now. And think about the whole Xbox era and the 360 era, and how they were going after Sony and against them, and Peter Moore showing tattoos, and it was trying to get Sony games day and date on Xbox. Like, it was a war. It was a console war. And it started as a console war. That's Microsoft started the console war. Because they built a console specifically in response to Sony PR and Sony's positioning of being the entertainment in the living room. So who started the war? Who started? They built a box to compete directly. It wasn't. And that's why when you watch the history of Xbox, they figured, we're going to do it. Well, where are we going to get the games? That's why they went over to Nintendo and said, oh, well, just buy Nintendo. We'll just buy Nintendo. We're going to go ahead with this. All right, who's going to make the hardware? Who's going to make the games? Like, that was their response. And then they realized when nobody wanted to take them seriously, they had to do it themselves. If you go watch the original story of the Xbox, they had to do it themselves because Nintendo laughed them out of the corporation. They're like, yeah, get out of here. You're not buying us. Because they thought they could just go buy somebody to make games for their console and then build and make somebody go make their console. And then they realized that they had, and they just wanted to provide the DirectX socket. There you go. But they had somebody, they had to go do it themselves. And when I did that video here, when Robbie Bach, what's up, Boyskies? When Robbie Bach came in, and Robbie Bach is like, you know what? I guess we're going to do it ourselves. And that's how the Xbox started. And now, look where we are. So thank you, Seamus Blackley, for bringing that history lesson back to us as to why the Xbox existed. It wasn't because Microsoft wanted to be in the gaming space. It wasn't because Microsoft had some, you know, entertainment that they wanted to share or do anything new. It was to compete against the Sony PlayStation in the living room. It was built for that. Let me get to these chats.
That was a response to some Sony PR that I read right before getting on a flight to Boston. And by the time I came back to Redmond, I had this whole presentation about how we should take the graphics technology I was working on for Windows and make a specific, you know, set PC whose specs wouldn't change so we could compete with the PlayStation. And the next thing you knew, it was a game console.
Boom. Nassim, member for 7 months. Buy a PS5, Phil Ness. Maybe then you'll find the lamb sauce. That's right. Phil Ness. Bah.
I would have been swallowed.
Where's the lamb sauce?
B. Carter, legit member for 13 months. Yo, he's a golden grinder. There he is, B. Carter. What makes Xbox dying so special? It will finally shut up these dudes thinking they ever competed with Sony. Xbox had bad games, controllers, and consoles. Yeah. I would say I liked it. Their controller design was pretty good. I did like it. Their games were decent. I liked their games. They had good games. They just stopped. They stopped, man. Because they took their eye off of the prize, B. Carter. Thank you for the chat. But they took their eye off the prize. I'm not going to say that they were horrible from the beginning, but they definitely showed their true colors, unfortunately. And now their true colors are being shown. We all understand it's a business. It's a business for Nintendo. It's a business for Sony. It's a business for Microsoft. But the problem is now is that Microsoft's making it all business. And it's not fun. And gaming has taken a back seat. And you could say, oh, but they spent money. It doesn't matter. They spent all this money, and you got Xbox gamers here going, what about me? And it's like, are you kidding me? They thought that money was being spent for them. They thought that them going to PC and getting that money from PC gamers was going to bring more money to them, more games to them from PC. It was a one-way ticket, man. It was a one-way street. Pew. And that's why they pushed that TV, 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 because that was the whole reason. They wanted to own the living room. And now they're at the part where people are not in the living room. We got to own the person where they are. And that's why he's talking portables. That's why they talk cloud. They're trying to get that person that's on the go. Like, nobody's sitting in their living room anymore, apparently. Everybody's like, wherever, every room is a living room now because everybody don't come around a TV anymore. Everybody just watches shows on their phones or on their tablets. So why don't we just be there on their phones and tablets? And it's like, yeah, it sounds intelligent. Yeah, it sounds right. Yeah, okay. We be where the customer is. But the problem is you keep talking about supply, supply, supply. Be where they are. But where's the demand? There's no demand for you. There's no demand for your content. And content is king. The problem is you took care of the supply, but there's no demand. So you're everywhere right now. How are you still running around with your head in the sand? But when you created that box, you had one target in mind: to beat the PlayStation. And you were all about beating that PlayStation until you needed them, because you realize you will never beat them at their own game. So you have to disrupt. So one way they tried to disrupt is they tried to make the most powerful, powerful, powerful console in the world. They tried it with the 1X. People bought into that $500 1X, the most powerful, powerful console. But short-lived, 2.5 years. No games from Microsoft. They bought studios. Too bad studios can't run on a 1X. Too bad studios don't do anything for a console unless they're making games, which it takes time. They bought them in 2018. They announced a new console. New console had no games. Just wait. Just wait. So they said, hey, guys, let's try it again. And let's do it with Project Scarlet in 2019. We'll beat Sony before they even talk about their console. We'll kind of do what we tried to do with the 360. We'll get a jump on them and start talking about our next console before Sony even could do it. And let's give them all the goodness. Grinders, get ready. Because this 3 minutes of video is going to make you cringe in your seats. Because this is absolutely ridiculous. And if we go back to our good friends over at Digital Foundry, our magnet players over there, let's go to the magnets just to kind of refresh everybody before we dive into that. Why don't we hear about what the good DF had said about the Xbox?
PS5 gets away with a higher setting than all other releases, though quite why this is the case is a mystery. But it's the point is, we're seeing too many inexplicable issues like this, and it's not just limited to Hi-Fi Rush. It's affecting a range of games on Xbox.
Just a reminder.
It began with Ghostwire Tokyo, which released on Xbox a year after its prior timed exclusivity with PlayStation 5. At this point, developer Tango Gameworks was an Xbox first-party studio, and yet, despite the extra year to work on an Xbox Series X release, arriving in April 2023, the game was tangibly worse than the existing PlayStation 5 version released in 2022. Even to this day, running brand new tests on the performance modes on each, using their 120Hz outputs, PS5 still has a visible frame rate lead. The difference is by as much as 10 frames per second and will be entirely hidden if running on a 60Hz display, obviously.
My goodness.
But it was the case then and still is the case. Equally, we still see other key advantages on PS5 today that aren't addressed. The quality mode's ray tracing features, the RT reflections, still run...
Let's pause it here. Ray tracing. Just put that little nugget in the back of your head. Just the little nuggets.
At a higher quality level on PS5.
Wait.
Other more easily avoidable issues have also emerged.
Here's just a reminder
running on its PS5 launch build.
A refresher. 120, 60 frames. A refresher.
2024.
Keep going.
It released with a unique 120Hz mode on Sony's platform, which was not present on Xbox Series X at the time.
Flabbergasted.
A wide range of games where the smaller GPU and slower CPU on PS5 somehow routinely offers up palpable advantages over Series X. A big case in point is this test, where we got Cyberpunk 2077's internal PC benchmarks running on both console versions, where PS5 shows an advantage.
Oh man, flabbergasted.
It's also crucial that Microsoft maintains a reputation that Xbox is the best place to play its own games,
especially
as it seems clear that more games will transition to PlayStation in due course.
Oh my goodness, that is just a refresher. All right, that is a refresher to know the state that we're in now. That is just a sampling of it. But now, let's react. Knowing what we know now, hit that like button, Grinders. We're going to go back in time to 2019. And let's go hear about the most powerful, powerful Scarlet in the world. And let me mind you some other Phil Ness that went on here. They showed their most powerful console first. We never knew about Lockhart, Project Lockhart, the Series S. That was shown after. They led with the best, and they spoke from their chest. Yes, I did make that shit rhyme. It's part of my musical talents that we have there. But anyway, Grinders, let's go listen to Uncompromised.
When we think about the future of gaming, it's not just PC, it's not just console, it's not just mobile. It's really all of the above.
It's everything.
Xbox is all about choice. We're investing in technology all throughout the game stack.
We put the fan at the center of every decision we make.
The games you want with the people you want on the devices that you want.
And for us, that starts with our next generation console.
Oh man, here we go.
We don't want to build just another console. We truly want it to be transformative.
It uses magnets. Here we go. Just listen to all the words that they say.
More immersion, more exploration, more detail.
So how do we make it easier for people to get into the game, to stay in
the
game?
One of the things that gamers and developers are incredibly excited about is reducing load times.
I'm an RPG gamer, and so, like, loading screens are a thing. So-
I need to stop it right there.
Gaming.
What you watching, little bro? Caught you!
I gotta
in
20K
stop it! HDR 1200 FPS Super Nintendo iOS 49 Blu-ray Ultraviolet Radiation 1080p PlayStation 5!
I gotta stop it right there. Did she say, and load scrum? I'm an RPG gamer, and loading is a thing. Holy Spirit! Find this. Knowing! Holy shit, I'm a thing! Knowing what we saw with Starfield! Loading screens. This shit writes itself. It writes itself. It's a thing, she said. Get ready. They double down on the loading screens. Let's hear that again for those in the back. Grinders who are just coming down on you. Get ready. Loading screens are a thing. This lady, I don't know who she is, but she's probably can't be excited about Starfield.
Developers are incredibly excited about is reducing load times.
I'm an RPG gamer, and so, like, loading screens are a thing.
Sitting there in the fake elevator because you know that the game's loading in the background. This is just an elevator ride forever. That's our goal with gaming.
Man, that lady just threw Mass Effect. Craig, wherever you are, Craig the tech guy, she just shit on your Mass Effect right there. She called that elevator horseshit. She just basically threw Mass Effect under the bus. See? Big Razzo's cheeks pucking up. It's cringe. This is cringe. She didn't know about next-gen load screens. She didn't know about that you got to do 3 load screens to get on the ship in Starfield. Incredible. And then that other lady comes in there and she throws Mass Effect under the bus. Which is crazy. Is that Mass Effect in those elevators? Was Mass Effect 1, which was an Xbox exclusive game. Oh my God. What are we, Grinders? What are we doing here? I knew how to react live.
Holy Spirit, activate.
Oh no.
Holy Spirit,
this lady.
Activate. Holy Spirit, activate. Activate.
She just threw Mass Effect, the Xbox exclusive Mass Effect 1, with the elevators.
Ground. This is just an elevator ride forever. That's our goal with gaming.
Man,
is that
she,
you
just,
don't-
she just trash on Mass Effect. Craig, that's for you, man. She just, where's Mass Effect talk here? She just trashed on Mass Effect 1.
Have those pauses.
This generation is
There he is. Here we go. Now we're getting to the juice.
Special because we've really unlocked this new capability to connect with the characters and worlds in a way that no previous generation has allowed. This generation,
I don't know what the hell Phil Ness is talking about. We're connecting with characters that the next generation, the previous generation has never allowed. I don't know. Is he talking about Master Chief? I don't know how we're connecting with his bootleg characters and I guess in updates. I don't know.
Is going to be a bigger leap than any generation we've done before.
He's gone. They find
the heart of our next generation console is our custom design processor, leveraging the latest Zen 2.
There he is. I just don't recognize him without the serial in the background. But anyway, we'll hear from him again.
Heavy technology from our partners at AMD. From a pure processing perspective, this is 4 times more powerful than the Xbox One X. We're leveraging high bandwidth GDDR6 to ensure that we're getting the best performance possible.
It's gonna usher in resolution and frame rates that we've never seen before. Like, never seen before.
We're looking at frame rates up to 120 frames per second.
8K capability, variable.
Capabilities. That fell out of my chair. It fell out of my chair. 8K capability. What are we doing here? This guy. Where's this guy? He needs a talking to. They're not even hitting 4K. This guy's talking about 8K capabilities. Oh, shit. They get on Sony's ass because they put it on the box. They had a guy out here say it to your face. Oh, damn. We're going to see. Oh, my. She's like laughing like 120 frames. You'll never get.
Up to 120 frames per second.
Oh, my God.
8K capability variable.
Dude, where's that guy? We need to find him.
Refresh rate.
Next gen ray tracing.
Whoa. Excuse me. Wait, did she just say next gen ray tracing? Not current gen ray tracing. Next gen. That's why I got the closed captioning on this piece. Next gen ray tracing? Holy spirit. I gotta smash that Holy Spirit again. Did she just say
next? Hidden if running on
next gen ray tracing. Holy crap. Lady, are you talking about this? Is this next gen ray tracing right here with it's in Ghostwire Tokyo, the game that you own?
Tracing features, the RT reflections still run at a high quality level on.
Is this next gen ray tracing for this, Lee? What are we doing here? It's a bug. Oh shit, there we go. Shut it down. Shut it down. Maddie Beast just told us it's a bug. Alright, there's just a bug. It's a mystery. It's a bug. They seem pretty damn confident here.
Refresh rate.
Next gen ray tracing. It's real time because it's hardware accelerated for the first time ever.
Where are these people? We need some answers.
PS5. Other more easily run. We still see other key advantages on PS5 today that aren't addressed. The quality mode's ray tracing features, the RT reflections, still run at a high quality level on PS5. Other more easily.
Oh my goodness. And wait, that other guy said, Mike Ybarra got let go twice. We're going to see frame rates you're never going to see before.
The avoidable issues have also emerged.
Exactly.
Here's Pentiment.
We're going to see 60 frames on a freaking PlayStation, on the Xbox, a year old, as a bug. 120 frames. You're not seeing them. Usher in frame rates my ass. This is ludicrous. Who wrote this shit? Oh, here goes this lady. Oh, here we go. Miss Lude Screens. Here we go. I want to interview her after goddamn Starfield.
What I'm personally most excited about is the SSD.
Oh,
we've created
shit.
A new generation of SSDs. We're actually using the SSD as virtual RAM.
Oh,
we're
no. Our 8K guy is telling us about SSDs. I thought only Mark Cerny talked about the SSD. Hi, everybody. This is some horse shit right here. Oh, shit. Mark Cerny, everybody. He's in here. Mark Cerny, welcome. Cerny, come in here. Did somebody say, my word, SSD? Nobody talks about the SSD like Mark Cerny, like me. Nobody. I'm the only one that talks about the SSD. So I don't know who these frauds are, but this is some grade A bullshit. Oh my God, Mark Cerny, you cussing. Cerny, calm down. Some grade A bullshit. I don't want to talk about the SSD. The PS5 power and the SSD? Mm-mm. And if you think that's crazy, get ready for the PS5 Pro. I'm just going to give you a little tease. Cerny in the house. Cerny, thank you very much. Now, I don't know who these frauds are, but this is some grade A bullshit. My God. Yo, Cerny, please. Please, sir. Thank you, Cerny. I know it's late. I know you're cussing. Cerny's cussing, everybody. We are. It is crazy in this grindhouse. Goddamn Mark Cerny cussing. We got people talking about SSDs. Get me back on. I'm just so pissed off. I woke from my slumber to listen to the gaming grindhouse. And I see this fraudulent shit going on here. And only I know about the SSD and offloading. What did this fraud talk about? I talk about the SSD. And this guy tell me about offloading RAM and shit. He's a stupid 8K coming bitch. It's a bullshit. My God. Okay, Cerny. Thank you. Calm down. Go back to your slumber. Get ready for the PS5 Pro. Cerny, thank you very much, Cerny. Everybody, thank you, Mark Cerny, for coming in here for a late night grindhouse. Somebody said SSD. He woke up. Holy crap. Thank you, Mark Cerny. We're going to get back to the video. My goodness. Cerny cussing. You don't get it anywhere yet. I never knew the guy cussed. He cussing here. His late night grindhouse, goddamn Cerny cussing. Holy shit. Oh, my goodness. Sam the Lotus is spirit with a 10, yo. He's wrecked. Cerny's pissed, man. He heard the words SSD. He woke up. Cerny sleeps upside down. I know. You know, he's the neighbor to the grindhouse. He sleeps upside down. Mock Cerny. He heard SSD. He freaking swooped in here like the freaking vampire. He's like, nobody talks about offloading RAM and shit. That's Cerny's job. Well, hey, man. We got Cerny cussing here. Everybody. I don't know, man. Yo, he might pop in again. I don't know. If they keep talking shit in this video, Cerny ain't coming here. He's knocking me out of my chair again. All right. Thank you, Cerny. All right. He left, everybody.
You're my number one customer.
More than 40 times performance increases over the current generation.
Oh, my God.
The combination of the SoC and the solid-state drive are...
What I need to know is this is all 40 times and 4 times the power. Are they talking about the 1X? Are they talking about the VCR Xbox? Because I think that's what they're referring to, the VCR Xbox, the original one. I don't think they're talking about the 1X. But anyway, let's hear about more of this. Let's see how far they can dig this hole.
Really what gives you a totally new experience.
Now we can take all of that power and apply it back into the scene. So we can actually generate more life in that world and bring it to the gamer in a seamless way. So that then you're...
No. Oh, no. Do you see what they're showing? Oh, my God. The fake Halo video.
Let me see that booty drop. Booty drop.
Means when I think about Xbox, I'm going to think about quality games.
They're showing the Halo bootleg CGI video that never even was the game. Yo. This guy showing fake Halo videos talking about how they're going to put this in the scene. Nothing aged well. That's right, Swaybag. Nothing aged well. Ryan says, it's great to hear about all the things they're not doing. Phil's excited about the things he didn't do. This is a great thing. Did Phil save Xbox? What game is this? Michael Meridian. Oh, my goodness. He needs to know what game is this. Yeah, what game is it? What game it is? Oh, goodness gracious. Is this the... wait a second. It's Halo. Mike, you didn't see it. Didn't you play Halo Infinite? That's Halo Infinite. You didn't play Halo Infinite? Yeah. You missed it? Who missed this? This is Shit Space. Oh, I mean Slipstream. Not Shit Space. Slipstream.
Actually generate more life in that world.
They could generate more life in the world. This is the Halo. You missed it? Who missed it? I don't know. This is the game I played. I don't know what you guys are talking about. Grinders. It might be too late for you guys. Halo Infinite E3 2018 game announcement. I don't know if you missed it. I played this game. Did you play this game? I played this game. Here it is. This is the Halo game. Look at 64. Look at this. Look, game engine demonstration. This was Halo Infinite. What an incredible game. Oh, my God. This is what they're showing. This is the power of the Series X. Here you go, Michael. Refresher. Here it is, Grinders. The tapes. Oh, look at this. With the fidelity. Oh. What is this game? Oh, my goodness. What's that? Ooh, is this Jurassic Park? What game is this? Oh, my. Look at these animals. Is this the Lion King? Oh, remember this from Halo Infinite? You remember the rhino herd? You fought the rhino herd. You remember this? This was like in scene 3. You remember this part? Look at this. Look at the textures of the trees. This is Halo. Halo Infinite. E3. Xbox official channel. Halo channel. Look at their... Look. Master Chief was swimming. Remember the submarine? Remember all this? Uh-oh. What's this? What could this be? Look at the fidelity of this. My goodness. The Series X is going to deliver incredible. Incredible. Look at the Halo trees. Oh my goodness. There it is. Oh my god, look! Dun, dun. I don't know what game you played. I played this. Dun, 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 dun. The real song they should have had is that from the day we arrived on the planet. Descend into the sun, where the sun rode in high on a sapphire sky. You'd be more the end in the circle of bullshit. That's what this is, Lutus. Where's Simba? From the day we arrived on the planet. It's the circle of life. I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about. Swagman's like, enough. Hey. They play the music and everything. Halo Infinite. Dun-da-da. Powered by Shitspace. You know, the 10-year engine. Circle of Filness. When the animals, they don't do seasons anymore, Ryan. They don't. Maybe the animals will show up in content update. What are they on? 40? Content update 39. There it is. Powered by slip space. A shit space. Uh-oh. You see that? Listen, Paramount Plus Master Chief, take notes. Cortana goes in the back of the armor, not in the crack of Master Chief's ass. All right, look at this. For if you care about your content, Master Chief, Cortana goes into his armor as a chip. All right, Paramount Plus Master Chief, Cortana went in the crack of his ass. All right, there it is. See, that's where Cortana goes, Paramount Plus Master Chief, not in the crack of the ass. All right, and there you go, Xbox signal. Branding, jump in, jump out. Plays best on Xbox One. Oh my goodness. What happened to this? Grinders, do we remember this statement? Plays best on Xbox One. Oh my goodness.
Best on Xbox.
What was that?
Games play best on Xbox One.
Oh man, I need that clip. I need that sound bit.
Games play best on Xbox One.
Oh my. I hope that's true today in 2024. Games play best on Xbox? Mm-hmm. Anyway, that was a refresher course for all you grinders out there. This is Halo. So just by the way, now that they show that, our gentleman now...
power and apply it back into the scene so we can actually generate more life in that world and there bring it go. To the gamer in a seamless way.
So that then you're fully experiencing what the game developer wants you to experience.
When you can move through worlds without waiting for screens to load, that's... speed, that performance is what the next generation is about.
Oh,
performance
no.
is about waiting for...
Oh my God. Grind, did you hear this? He talked about load screens again!
Experience.
When you can move through worlds without waiting for screens to load, that speed, that performance is what the next generation is about.
This is the...
Oh my God! Oh my God, we gotta do the all global head slap. That guy is talking about moving worlds. That guy is talking about going worlds without load screens. He didn't mention going in parts of a ship with load screens. Yeah, he forgot about that part. He said we're moving worlds without load screens, but he said, oh, yeah, well, Starfield, we gotta do a load screen to get on the ship, then a load screen to get into the captain's chair, then a load screen to take off from the planet. He talking about load screens all over different worlds.
The low, that speed,
that's
that
next generation
is
to
what
him.
The next generation is about.
This is the most immersive console experience ever.
Oh no.
What we really want to do is give developers the power to build the game they've always envisioned.
We have hundreds.
Oh, no. Give developers the power of the console that they always envision. Oh, my goodness. Magnet players. Magnets, where are you? Magnets! Magnets, get over here. Get over here, magnets. The most
Xbox support due to quote unquote flatlining performance. What do you make of this? To develop for? With development costs increasing, you would think publishers would want to.
It's just smaller, and it's not helpful that it's more complicated to develop for. And it's also not helpful that there are, you know, two units out in the market right now. One of them is significantly compromised. The Series S, from all that I've heard, is a really challenging system to work with for some, especially higher end games. I also think that yeah. Xbox customers are used to Game Pass, and they're used to...
My goodness. Digital Foundry, what did they say? Significantly compromised. Oh, damn. So do you see what they did? Well, let's finish it up. First of all, giving people the power, do you see what they did? They neutered themselves because this was all without the announcement of Project Lockhart, the Series S. All this, I think, was great marketing to go into the next generation, but then they neutered it because then they announced the Xbox Series S later on. If you remember that. The S wasn't in existence right now. This is all X. They spent the whole year of 2019 for talking about the X. They showed it. They called it the Series X at the Game Awards at the end of 2019. And the S was not announced until the summer or spring, summertime, around this time of the following year. Project Lockhart. That's when they basically compromised themselves. But just remember, the mentality here was this is the most powerful, uncompromised, AK, all this stuff. Because that was all they were talking about. But they knew that they were working on a weaker console. And that was going to compromise everything that this console was so quote-unquote capable of. But you got to remember, they were getting ahead of the PlayStation 5, who never announced their system until next summer, 2020. So they try to get a jump on next generation by starting with this Project Scarlet. Mm-mm-mm. But they're not in it to win it, right, Phil? You're not competing against PlayStation, right, Phil?
Of people across both our first-party studios as well as our third-party studios working on those next-generation experiences today.
It's an amazing commitment.
They were working on it today. So in 2019, they were working on Xbox next-generation games. So if they're working on them today, then why did you have no games at launch? And this gentleman right here, Greenwald, or Greenberg, whoever his name is, head of Forza. Forza, who just released their game of the generation, of this generation, at the end of 2023.
To content at Xbox Game Studios. 13 studios, 7 in the last year. That's a big family.
At 343, for us it's always about more seamless worlds with the next generation. We can bring the world to life in a way we've never experienced Halo before.
We're delivering
Holy Spirit, activate.
Oh, no.
Holy Spirit, no. Oh, activate. No. Holy Spirit, activate. Activate.
Did I just see Bonnie Ross talking about Halo and showing that CGI again with Elton John and the circle of bullshit? Did I just see that? I look to the left to see the chat. I look to my right, and I hear Bonnie Ross talking about goddamn Halo. It's hard being green, Ryan. It's hard being green. Did I just see what I saw? I got to check this out.
Three, for us, it's always about more seamless worlds with the next generation. We can bring the world to life in a way we've never experienced Halo before.
Oh, no, not like this. Oh, no. Oh, my God. Oh.
Oh, no. We suck again.
Oh, no. Oh. Oh, I don't. This is too much for this late at night, guys. This may be a bad decision in the gaming grindhouse. This is too much for this late at night. Man, oh man, we got Bonnie Ross talking about Halo immersion, and what did she say about these worlds? We can bring the world to life, and we could bring the world to life. Oh my goodness. Did she say we could bring the world to life? Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Bonnie, not like this. We got Bootleg Joel, everybody. Bootleg Joel's back in the gaming grindhouse. Bootleg Joel. Get him, Bootleg. Show me about this world. Bootleg Joel, get out there. Wake up, Bootleg Joel. Bootleg, wake up.
No, get no. You, I can't stand this.
Get him, Bootleg.
Who you are?
Breathe.
No, you don't get to tell me what to do. You don't get to tell me anything. We're. Are you even listening?
I count three anti-aircraft cannons.
Three what?
You'll be safe here.
I'm safe. Safe? I haven't been safe since I found you. I found you, remember? You were out there on your own, and you'd still be out there if it wasn't for me. I thought I was going home.
There won't be a home if we don't stop the banished.
We don't care. You keep saying that. We're outgunned, outnumbered.
Tell him, Bootleg.
I know I saw clone wars over there. I'm going to dig through them and find one with the working
Fernando!
When you're done with this war, we'll get away from here. Far away.
Wait here.
Oh.
Grindus, did you hear that? I bursted into song. My dog's going wild. I bursted into song. We have Bootleg Joel back in the gaming grindhouse. Holy crap. You know what? It bursted into song. Bootleg Joel returns. Fernando. Let's see these worlds that Bonnie's talking about.
Please.
Together.
All right, Bootleg, get back in the building. Get out of your building.
Okay, big guy.
All right, big guy, let's go. Show me these worlds, Halo. Oh, here it is. Look at these worlds. Oh, my God. Oh. Look at the animals. Look at the tree. Look at these things. What are these? Oh, my God. Look at this. But this is not the game that they showed, though.
You can bring the world to life.
Tell me about it again, Bonnie. Tell me about it. Oh, here it is. So this is what I was supposed to see when I walked out.
With the next generation.
I was supposed to see this.
Three. For us, it's always about more seamless worlds.
All right. I was supposed to see this. Let's see. Did we see this? Did I miss something? That's what we're supposed to see. Did we see this? Let's see. Those trees don't look like the trees I just saw. Look at the animals. Look at these things. Grindhouse. Wait. Grindhouse. We need to do something here. Grindhouse. Gaming Grindhouse. Enhance. I need to enhance. What are all these things? I heard that there's animals here. There they are.
When I get back.
It's not working the way I wanted to do. I wanted to go back just a little bit. I gotta see what this is. Because I saw rhinos and all this lovely animals in the video. I need to see what I'm missing here. Enhance. Look at these. Does this look like the rhinos? What the hell is this thing? This don't look like the rhinos that I just saw. Where's Elton John? This is not making me go into song. Where's Elton John? Where that Bonnie? Where are these animals? What the hell's this? And you wonder why people are like, oh, you're just being hard on Halo. It's Xbox tax, dude. This is tax-free shit right here. This is what they talked about. This is what they were hyping when talking about next gen. And then this is the Halo game that they shown. And you wonder why they talk too much. They made this bed. Now they gotta sleep in it. This is exactly why things went down the way it did. Because they built this on that anticipation. Because we didn't know what next gen was gonna look like. And the way that guy, 8K and unprecedented frame rates that we've never seen before. And graphics and SSDs because loading is a thing. All this stuff. What we were shown and what was delivered. And on top of that, this wound up getting delayed a whole year to 2021. And it still looked like this. If you remember, the wonderful Halo Rat, one of the old mascots of the Gaming Grindhouse, the hairless rat, still looks like ass. But these are the things. Bonnie, what were you saying again?
With the next generation, we can bring the world to life in a way we've never experienced.
Wait, look at this part. Look at this part. Oh my goodness. Does he get on the thing and start jamming? Let me see. I think he does. Let's see. That's what we were told. Let's see. That's what they were telling us. Now let's go visit it again. Oh my goodness. Look at these effects. Oh my god, it looks even horrible in Digital Foundry, Grinds Foundry zoomed in. We gotta get out of this because this is hurting it. It is hurting it. But let's see. He gets on the here we go. Oh, here we go. Look at this. It was the lighting. That's what they said. Still, here we go. Nice lighting popping in and stuff. Here we go. So quiet. There's Craig. Quality gaming, right, Phil? There he is. Incredible. Did it look like this? Nope.
Halo before. The life in a way we've never experienced Halo before.
Yeah, that was never experienced Halo before. Damn right. Smoothless grunt right there, the hairless Craig.
We're delivering 4 generations of content better than you've ever seen them before.
This console is especially awesome for Game Pass members. With the faster load times, you're going to be able to experience all the games within just a snap of your fingers.
We're giving gamers the option to connect across devices and across platforms in a way that we never were able to before.
I don't lose my last generation as I move into
the next generation, the people I play with, and the games that I want to play. That experience should be continuous and always growing.
This isn't just a console launch. This is about the future of gaming.
Your games, your achievements, your progression, your accessories, your console gaming experience with Xbox, it all comes forward with Scarlet.
There you have it. There you have it. How crazy is watching that now? Yeah, it would have been crazy watching this after Halo Infinite launched in 2021. Now in 2024 and all the stuff with third party, not using the power of the cons, all this stuff. How crazy is it right now? And did you hear the words PC and consoles don't matter and no console required at the end of this thing? Did you hear any of that horse shit? Did you? Did I miss something? Did you miss consoles are not doing anything? Consoles are not moving anywhere. Consoles aren't the future. Growing. Phil said they're growing. What's up, Outside Gaming Night? How you doing, man? Yeah, Late Night Grindhouse. What? Ways you never done before. Power your dream. All this. Did you hear about consoles going away? No, I didn't hear that. 5 years later, right? Yeah, crazy, right? So you wonder, this is the bill that you were sold. But these guys who watched this video and hyped this shit up are the same ones like, well, Jim Ryan said about generations. Dude, are you kidding me? Everything that Sony showed in that show was playable and played, came out and released. I'm still finding out where the hell are those Halo trees? Where are those Halo animals? Because what Sony showed at their showcase when they launched that PS5, we played it, reviewed it, and it's done. Where are the seconds? We played Miles Morales. We did Demon's Souls. We did God of War. We did Horizon Forbidden West. We did Forbidden West DLC. We did Valhalla. We did all that stuff. We did Spider-Man 2 already. We did Ratchet and Clank. We did Returnal. It's all done. It's done and it has been sealed away. Go buy a PS5 or play it later on PC. Damn, Sony put it out somewhere else because it's been so long. We're still waiting for all this bullshit that you guys talked about. You want to talk about SSDs? You talked about SSDs first. I had to wake up Cerny to get on this show. You're the ones that talked about
8K capability, 8K. Variable refresh rate.
Next-gen ray tracing. It's real-time because it's hardware accelerated for the first time ever.
What I'm personally most excited about is the SSD.
We've created a new generation of SSDs. We're actually using the SSD as virtual RAM.
We're seeing more than 40 times performance increases over the current generation.
The combination of the SoC and the solid state drive are really what gives you a totally new experience.
So in 2019, these guys were the first ones talking about SSDs and VRAM and all that shit. Did you see anybody getting on their case about the SSD being next generation? Because I know when Cerny did that Snorefest and he talked about the SSD. When he talked about that SSD, everybody was crawling up Cerny's ass going, it's just an SSD, Cerny, stop it. They talked SSDs in 2019. They talked 8K before Sony even revealed their PS5. They talked about it, Microsoft, Xbox, in their sizzle reel, in this show, in 2019 E3, talked about their SSD and what it's going to do to next generation, and they talked about the 8K. Oh, but let's crawl up Cerny's ass and get on him for the SSD. Oh, really? Now SSD, and let's try to prove that wrong with Ratchet and Clank. Oh, we're going to see it doesn't need an SSD. Oh, really? Where was the criticism and analysis for these clowns? They talked about it a year before Mark Cerny even mentioned the words SSD. But nobody was crawling up that ass. Wanna, member for 5 months. He goes, I am yet to be told why any PC gamer would shift from PC or Steam Deck and go pick up an Xbox handheld. Everyone is already happy skipping Xbox. Wanna. The main thing is, the only people that will buy an Xbox handheld are the ones that are on the remaining Xbox right now. It is a transitional hardware. It is not a recruiting hardware. A handheld Xbox will not do anything to bring in new customers. A handheld Xbox will take the remaining people on a console who realizing that that ship is sinking and jump on the little rinky-dink lifeboat of an Xbox just to say they still have an Xbox. And Phil knows that. It's a transition. He tried to get them off the console and go to PC. They didn't. They stuck there thinking Phil cared about console. Phil didn't really do a great job because he kept trying to shove more console hardware in their face, making it look like they still cared about the console. Meanwhile, he didn't give a flying shit about it. And they believed in Phil. Oh, Phil's making more hardware. I'll buy another console from Phil. Go ahead. You don't believe in it. And now you didn't leave. So he's going to make you leave by building you a mobile Xbox so you leave. He tried to convince you with an Asus Ally. You still didn't go. He's going to try to make a console-fied little Xbox. And guess what? Nobody's going to buy it because it all comes down to games. That's they're everywhere right now to this day. They're on 99% of the electronics. They're on every TV, every phone, every tablet, every PC, Chromebooks, every browser. The game could be played anywhere. Why are they struggling? They're everywhere right now. It's because they don't have the games that people want to play. And Microsoft does not do a good game at all trying to even sell their games or market them. I saw a bunch of people on Twitter today saying, where the hell is Hellblade 2 marketing? Nobody knows. Nobody cares. Microsoft don't even give a shit. They don't care.
I'm here to tell you right now, we don't care.
They don't care. Right, they don't care.
Number one customer.
They don't care about their games. And they don't care about them. They have no confidence in them. Marketing for Hellblade, you wouldn't even know Hellblade 2 is coming out. Meanwhile, you're playing demo of Stellar Blade after playing a litany of exclusive games from PlayStation that they brought marketed and sold and got people hyped for it. That Hellblade demo, that Stellar Blade demo, And then if it's true, and I'll talk about more about this on the next shows and stuff, but like, you know, what's going on? If there's a showcase in May for Sony's next line, come on. Hellblade 2 is fighting an uphill battle already. And Microsoft don't care. They don't care. Game night with the five, he goes, I remember people making fun of Mark Cerny when he said how dangerous to judge everything off of teraflops or something to that extent. Right? That's right. Thank you, Game Night, for the super chat. That's right. They jumped down Sony's throat when they were talking about how powerful the PS5 was and what the capabilities of the SSD and all that other stuff was. And everybody just accepted this. And look at where we are today. I could show you specific examples of what Cerny was talking about, and we could show them in games that we just played already from launch games. These guys talked about this in 2019, and it is a comedy act looking at what they released and what the capabilities of the machine are from the software that's out and what they were saying. So tell me who's the liar. You could say SSD from Cerny, and I show you Ratchet and Clank. Done. I show you other games, how you quick load, even games that third-party games. The controller, nobody's going to use the DualSense. Remember, nobody was going to use that gimmick. Now Microsoft is using it to put their own exclusive games on PlayStation. Meanwhile, these guys are talking 8K a year before Cerny even took the stage. But nobody got on Microsoft's case. They were all hyped up about this. Because then what Sony did is when Sony announced the PS5, Microsoft, instead of doubling down on the power of the Scarlett, they announced the Project Series S Lockhart Booster. Oh, this is the great value box. Oh, and it was all about value the next year. This was all about power the year before. Because remember, in this world, after this showcase, it was just power. They were running off the 1X. They were trying to sell the Series X. Project Scarlet, end of the year. They showed Hellblade. They talked about, they called it Series X. That was it. Nobody knew of Booster until the summer of the following year, right around when Sony announced the PS5. And it backfired on them. And now, anything this console may be capable of, the S, is wasted. It's wasted because the S, basically, they knew to themselves. They tripped over their own feet. That's what they did. And now that we talked about the console, why don't we go to another gem of an article. So hit that like button, Grinders, because we're going to talk about this one. This is Gamescom of last year. And we're going to hear about games that were coming out. Exclusives. And the power of the Xbox brand. And again, knowing what we know now. And this is only just, say, 8 months ago? 9 months ago? Xbox still talking about Palace, son of Asgard? Yeah, I'm sure. I am sure. Josh says, Jez, if the industry isn't growing, how does reciting from the same game as you have grow the industry? It doesn't. It doesn't, Josh. That's why I mean. The only way to grow gaming is to do your part and is to make great games for people to be attracted to come play. That's what it is. Then you worry about where they could play those great games. Microsoft is consumed with growth and where people could play games. What's up, Twisted Sync? How you doing, man? They are so consumed with where, they never address the what and never have. So they're everywhere right now. And they think that's why they're in this pickle going, well, gaming is not growing. Yeah, it's not growing because you ain't doing your job in making great games. Look how Helldivers 2 brought in a whole bunch of people. It brought PC gamers. It brought people in. And it is selling more and more and more. That's how you grow gaming. You make games that people who don't know about games or not on the cusp of knowledge jump on and play. That's what you do. You bring gamers and grow gaming with games. Not with playing on your phone and all these gimmicks. It's like a late night infomercial. It's like all I can see is Phil run around like on his phone, like in a black and white thing, like those infomercials. You know? It reminds me, this is like Microsoft, that's what they remind me of. They remind me of a late night infomercial. Like, you ever have that thing where you're just sitting on your deck and you want to play a game, but there's no console around to answer the questions of why can't you play the game? Well, this is where I come in with my Philnet strap-on. Yes, what about a plastic device that will plug into your phone and then you'll be able to play the game? Is this you at a late night convention and you can't play your game on the deck?
Number one customer.
Like, there he is. This is what they believe. This is how they're solving the problems here. This is Phil Spencer commercials. Well, this is you. This is how you like to watch it. I got a product for you. It is called a plastic device to stick on your phone. And now we'll solve the... It's like, nobody cares, Phil. I don't want to play the game. That's the problem. I'm sitting on my deck. I don't give a shit about your game. I don't care if you sell me a plastic device. I heard another... What? You have another issue? But wait, there's more. You know, it's just like they're trying to solve problems that they need. Like, that's what they need Phil with his goddamn, Phil's like, you know, I'm sitting here on my deck. This is the Xbox commercial. Philmercial. There you go. Infilmercial. There you go, Ryan. Thank you. New grand hashtag Infilmercial. There you go. You ever see those things? Infomercials. This is what they did. They're trying to solve. Oh, a portable Xbox. That's exactly what you need. Sir, are you trying to game on a phone? No, let me show you something to fix it. Philly Mays, exactly. We got Philly Mays. We got infomercial. Man, Ryan's bringing out all the goodness. That's what it's like. They're trying to figure out this. Well, a device will solve, like a portable Xbox will solve this issue. You know? Yeah, here's Phil trying to say, hey, let me, oh, wait, sir, you want to shred that lettuce? Oh, no, look, just buy a food processor. Infomercial, Philly Mays. There he is. There's Philly Mays. But wait, there's more. There he is. This is him. It's Phil. It's Phil at E3. It's Phil at E3.
Sign me, please. I will bend over and touch. Minis tell me it's better when we all play and make exclusive games and like. To my face, thank you, Phil. Wait till E3. There will be a showcase, but I can't say when all our games need help. Bootleg Studios helping with Perfect Dark.
Oh my god, Perfect Dark's even getting more help. Dude, they got another studio helping them. Philly Mays here. And here's Philly Mays. We got him right here. But that's what they're doing.
My number one customer.
They're trying to make that magical device that's going to broaden gaming. No, make the games first, then worry about where they're playing them. Because the first thing you gotta do is get people to be aware of it. You know, when people see Spider-Man or hear about this Helldivers 2, it's like, whoa, wait, what's this Helldivers 2? I gotta jump on this. What is that word of mouth? The reason why people, oh, wait, I heard about that. And that's what you do. It was funny. You know, just to, before we get into this video, I was watching the BlackBerry movie, right? Which is a pretty good movie. I was watching a BlackBerry movie, and one of the things they were doing to try to get people to buy the BlackBerry and stuff like that, where Apple just killed it with the, you know, with the iPhone. Before that, when they were trying to get there, what they did was they took their office people, and they gave them a BlackBerry and said, "I want you now to go to every restaurant. I want you to go to every country club and use that phone and make yourself loud and boisterous and laughing and just be enjoying the product that people will come over to you and go, oh, what is that? What is that thing? I got my and just be very boisterous about it. And that will get people's attention. Let people wonder, what are you talking on? What is that? What are you typing on? What is that? I had BlackBerries. But that was a strategy that he did to try to get people intrigued. Not put a commercial up there, but actually get it out there and get that word of mouth. Get people to look and say, whoa, whoa, what are you playing over there? What is that? Whoa, what game is that? Why do I see clips and I see in my social media feed all about this Helldivers 2? Whoa, whoa, look at that explosion. Whoa, they got this. Whoa, why is everybody talking about this? That's how you get gamers' attention. And now they go, where can I play that game? Where? They're not asking where. And then you go, okay, you can play everywhere. And then it's like, all right, what am I going to play? And Phil's like, we're working on that. That's the problem. That's why they're not growing. That's why they failed all these years. And I've been doing this grindhouse for all these years. That's why. Because they said, you could play everywhere. And everybody's like, oh, that's great, Phil. What am I going to play? And Phil's like, yeah. That I have to get back to you on. Wait to E3. It's like, oh, well, I don't give a shit if I can play on a phone. I can play on a tablet. I don't care. Like, what am I going to play? But if you make a great game, oh, Helldiver, where can I play that? Well, buy a PS5. Go get a PC. Okay, wow, that looks awesome. I'm going to go try it. And that's what you do. And that BlackBerry thing was funny because, like, you know, that was the thing. Like, they said, sit in a restaurant, just be talking on that thing loud, and business guy, people come up to you, I'm like, what's this? And you hand out your card. And I'm like, oh, yeah, well, there's a BlackBerry. It's like, know how many times I've sold something like that? That's how I used to sell. Just use it. Use it and have a great time. Enjoy it. And people will be attracted to say, well, what is that? What are you playing? What are you doing? Wait, that camera took those pictures? Yeah. I took a picture of a bird. It's like, wait, what took that? That camera? Yeah. Would you like to buy it? Sure. I wasn't coming in here to buy a $700 camera, but if that's the picture that it takes and you just took that picture with that camera, then yeah, I'll buy it. Dude, it's simple. It's business. That's exactly what it is. There's no numbers. There's no PLEs or whatever. It's common sense of consumerism. If there's something cool, something useful, and somebody's enjoying it, the word of mouth, the market will be there. But the product, due to talking, man, Ryan is on fire. I might have to do more late ones here because Ryan is just like, he's like my hype man in the grindhouse right now. He's like, if you call now, he calls Phil. He goes, Philly Maze, man. Ryan's like, he's like the, he's like goddamn hype man in the grindhouse right now. I have to do with the late ones, man. He kicks it on at 12 a.m. He's like, oh damn, East Coast 12 a.m. Let's go. Let me give Jez all his friggin' one-liners. Exactly. Outside, when you unfold, well, what is that? What? Oh, wait, you have a fold? Well, that opens up there. How did you get that? Where did you get it from? What service you use? Who makes it? And that, it's, dude, that's why it's about the friggin' games. If you want to grow gamers, you want gamers, then you make the games that people want to play. You don't come out with Halo looking like that ass. You show Halo the way it's shown there, and now people want to play it. You don't do that. Yeah, Little John. Yeah. What? Yeah. That's Ryan. Ryan's in the chat like that. He's like, Philly Maze. Yeah. What? Yeah. He's not a morning person. That's it. He's an F the dark person, Ryan. He's like, yeah, yeah. What? What? Yeah. Anyway, let's get into this one. Oh, my God. Let's do this video here. But, yeah, just to answer those chats, like, that's the thing. It's always the what. And then you say, where can I play it? And that's the Microsoft that fell face down. They bought all these studios. They got all these IPs, all this stuff. And they still don't have an answer to what are you going to play. It is dominated. The beginning of this year has been dominated with what's. It's been Final Fantasy, Helldivers 2, now Stellar Blade. Even Rise of Ronin was in there. And it's like, yeah, that's just, you know, that's a side. That's great. That's there. But like you had Helldivers, Rise of Ronin. You had all these games lined up. What? Last of Us Remastered. What? And you're sitting here and you're like, well, what is Hellblade 2? Well, I don't know. They showed us some clips of her walking around in January. What? Oh, okay. Grand Blue. Exactly, Josh. Like, Grand Blue, that was the other one I was missing. Like, Sony's been hitting you with the what? And it's like, well, wait, I got to play this somewhere else. Oh, well, I got something for you. Here's the PlayStation Portal. Now you can go play it off of the PlayStation. Oh my God.
You're my number one customer.
Wonderful. I was wondering where I could play Helldivers 2 away from my PlayStation. Well, there's the portal. That's when the what makes the where happen. But Microsoft, nope, it's the where. Play on your phone. Play over here. Play what, Phil? I don't know. Games that you want to play. Well, they're none of your games. Oh, well, what about choice? Well, I don't choose you. Well, I got to do something now. Exactly. Anthony Perez with the 5. He goes, imagine Toyota trying to take over the car industry by making their own Uber service instead of selling cars. That's what Xbox tried with gaming. And Anthony, that is a great point because, and you know, if I got that other clip from the devs. I'm going to do that on Friday's show. We're going to go over the GDC clips and, you know, other thing about Phil Spencer with the industry and stuff. But I want to react to another video. And I know I went on a little side piece of the what and the where. Well, I'll timestamp these just for you guys. But, you know, definitely it's relevant to the conversation there. But, you know, just the whole thing. You know, that was, again, that whole showcase response that there was basically the where. The 8K capability, this. But they never showed the what you're going to play. It was all lies. It was fake stuff. It was nothing. He said they're working on games now. Don't you think you should show some games with it? Oh, nah. It was all the what, no, the where. And you're right. What they did with gaming was they made the games not important. They made the games not important. They made the games less than and more about where you're going to play than about what you're going to play. And Game Pass, on top of that, made games not the driver. It made the service, the idea of Game Pass, the concept of it, appealing, but the content was never there to justify the hype for it. They had some good drops here and there, but it was never consistent. It was always like a one-off. And one-offs are not going to sustain a subscription service. One-offs aren't going to do that. They're going to be like, oh, okay, that's it. I'll drop off. Look at any subscription service. Now, speaking. What's up, Neil? Welcome back from vacation, man. Let's listen to some Phil Nessie and react to this. Hit that like button, Grinders.
To you, so it's like...
I saw the age.
Yeah, it's kind of like a 10 out of 10. I want to know what you're playing and why is it...
So this is Gamescom. First off, I don't care what he's playing because he's still playing Vanced by Survivors. I heard this already.
This is the first time in a while you've stepped on it as well. So I want to know why it's so important that Xbox has showed up so big this year.
Well, being here, being anywhere, but being in Europe with our customers, with players, with the creators that are here. I did a creator get together both last night, today, met with some partners. It's, yeah. You know, it's these moments where the industry comes together, where we can talk to each other, that the consumers can come in, the players can come in, put their hands on games. I just think it's critically important. Obviously, COVID messed up a bunch of things. We're kind of, that's in the rearview mirror. So when he had the opportunity this year to go big at Gamescom, we said, let's go. The other thing that's awesome in the booth is how much third-party support that's here. Right?
Yeah.
Like, Ed Boon's game's here, Mortal Kombat's here. Mm-hmm. We have the DLC for Cyberpunk's here. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just awesome to see how many of our partners, Rod's game's here, Diablo, how many of the third-party support on the floor. It's an important thing for us as a platform. It's just nice to get reconnected back with the community here.
Yeah. And then Starfield, I feel like I'm showing everyone over here.
I can't
here,
see it.
Starfield.
I can't see it. It's too small.
Well, it is actually technically massive.
This is before Starfield releases. Hear this.
Correct you there. And we're only a week away from early access, so how exciting is it seeing early this access. Game coming to Xbox, and we're so close now.
Yeah, we've been working on it for a long time. I've known about it for, you know, even before we acquired ZeniMax. So it's been great to see Todd and the team work more closely with them than we ever have on any game. You know, there aren't that many moments where we get to launch a new IP that has the amount of buzz and anticipation that Starfield does. A lot of games you'll launch that are new IP and then maybe they build into their strength. But, like, there is just a crazy amount of anticipation. And the thing that I love is the confidence that the team has right now.
Yeah.
Like, putting out review codes 2 weeks before launch.
Remember that? Remember that? Putting review codes 2 weeks before launch. Oh, man. Oh, man. Do you hear about that? They gave it to people that were going to give it high grades. Oh, my goodness. That's right, Josh. He's like, ah. The bullshit has to come out.
And I'll be the first to admit, the first 3 to 4 hours are a little bit hunt and peck, figure out, like, well, what am I actually doing? Then you get on a side quest or something, and, like, the game just, like, blows up in terms of its epic scale.
Uh-huh.
So I love the fact that the team is so confident in giving reviewers time with the game before they're actually reviewing or just, you know, talking about what
Sherry
they think picked. Of the game.
Yeah. And just...
And did Phil just say his own game takes 4 hours to get into it? Oh my goodness, Grinders. Whoa.
Phil Spencer, baby, let's go! Yes! 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 Yes!
Yes! He says it right there.
Time with the game before their actions that the team has right now.
Yeah.
Like, putting out review codes 2 weeks before launch. Because it's a big game, and I'll be the first to admit, the first 3 to 4 hours are a little bit hunt and peck, figure out, like, well, what am I actually doing? Then you get on a side quest or something, and, like, the game just, like, blows up in terms of...
in the rearview mirror, if you will, kind of. I think that's how it works. Forza Motorsports over there.
Yeah.
Oh my, now he's going to try to hype up Forza Motorsport. And we know how Forza Motorsport launched. Just recall, Forza Motorsport with the bad leveling up, all the graphical issues, the not great technical issue performance on the Xbox where it was lower than ray tracing. And then what they showed, remember, was incorrect. The ray tracing they showed on track was not the same thing that they shipped. Remember all that stuff with Forza? Just a little refresher before we go into the reaction. Remember all that.
And that's out not too long after Starfield, is it?
That's right. That's October. Uh-huh. We did a take home 2 weeks ago where we got the kind of the opening of the game. Looks fantastic. I'm a huge motorsport fan.
Yep.
And I'd say turn 10 for us for a long time in our first party has really been a technical showcase.
Mm-hmm.
Like Chris Techter, the team on the tech side, the stuff that they get the most out of the hardware,
yeah.
I think, of any of our first party teams. They just like, that's their focus, along with building a great
Did he say
racing
that?
Simulator. And it's the game looks fantastic. And
oh,
it's
yeah.
I can't wait for people to get to play. The ray tracing on track looks great, giving people some options. You'll see all that.
Oh my goodness, Phil, hyping up ray tracing on track. Oh. My goodness, my goodness. Philly Mays.
As far as I can tell, it doesn't do that. What it does do is it varies each setting that is set to auto based on your chosen dynamic render quality again. The settings for PC RTSS, and of course the in-game TAAU scaler. If you plug in an AMD GPU or... Okay, with image quality out of the way, let me get into all those Xbox Series X settings and how I specifically looked into the settings for Performance RT mode, which Oliver says is the best way to play the game on Xbox, and I find that mode the most interesting for PC compared to RT presets. See, the ground, livery quality, and rain quality. With rain quality, for example, low to ultra rare. Either way, the game's textures on track are much higher quality on PC with all settings and the pack installed. The other most obvious difference between PC Max and Series X would be in the cube map quality. On Xbox, as you move forward, you can see how the reflections update every other frame, and this correlates with the medium and low settings on PC. The high setting instead updates every 2 out of every 3 frames, so 2/3 of the time instead of half the time here actually. If I use these Xbox closest settings on an RTX 2070 Super at 1440p in DLSS balance mode, we can see that these settings improve the performance over the game's ultra settings by an impressive 63% when fully GPU limited. That's quite awesome to see indeed. But as I said, these are just the basis for PC GPU optimization that I'm going to use. I'm going to further improve on this. But beyond this, I also have separate recommended settings for higher end.
What do they say about the ray tracing?
By using mirror-like reflections.
As they kind of talk about more of the game.
Mm-hmm.
But Motorsport is tried like something that I'll... One of those franchises I've played since the beginning, and I can't...
So this week was Forza Motorsport Review Week. We had Oliver on the main console review there, and then Alex...
This is not a simple task. And what they've done, I think they've done well, and they've targeted the console platform with what it can handle, right? Although there's also the argument that
I totally heard about next gen ray tracing
a bit further. But you know, when you look at this trailer, you're really thinking like they're going all out with ray trace reflections. Like the quality of those reflections is very high, resolution is high, the full environment seems to be beautifully reflected against the car. Everything's there. But as we know in the final game, it's more the ray tracing is only drawn within a small sphere around your car and only really on like shiny paint surfaces, right? And anything like a meter or two away from the car, it either falls back to cube maps, SSR, or something else, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, and you see all those videos going around of like the night racing in the with the wet track, right? And it's all like, mm-hmm. everybody's like, yeah, ray tracing, but it's all just SSR. And it's you know,
literally just all SSR.
It's kind of funny, but also like, it does make you think like, wait, maybe SSR works pretty well in some games, like racing games.
Well,
like this, but no. Mean, yeah.
What was that again, Phil? About that? What does he say?
The ray tracing on track looks great, giving people some options. You'll see all that as they kind of talk about more of the game. Mm-hmm. But Motorsport is tried like something that I'll. One of those franchises I've played since the beginning, and I can't wait for the full
staple,
release.
Huh?
Yeah,
it's Motorsport. It's chef's kiss.
Well, like,
it's a chef's kiss.
Gen, they started with Motorsport, expanded to Horizon, so now they built like a sibling
a chef's
franchise
kiss,
to
said.
Motorsport.
Yep.
You know, they've just done such a really good job of growing the relevance of Forza, both for simulation and arcade players. Yeah.
Would you ship that?
Yeah, absolutely. So, Phil, I know one of the things in chat.
Man, Phil, we're 2 for 2 right now. Starfield, Forza. Don't tell me there's any more coming. Can't be. Can't be.
And many of the fans really appreciate about you is how much you love to play the games themselves. So I know just over here.
Oh, my goodness. He is a gamer. I forgot. Grinders, he's a gamer. Swagbag, he's a gamer. You forgot. This is a horse of a different color. He's a gamer. What did he play? I got to know.
Yeah, we can't see behind me. We've got the Stalker 2 demo.
Yeah,
Stalker 2
as well. It's been 16 years since the original, so can you tell us what stood out?
Phil, tell us all about it. Yo, he got to play Stalker 2. Phil's a gamer. He got to play Stalker 2. Let's hear what Phil has to say about this. Grinders, you're going to want to pay a lot of attention because there's a lot of detail in here. Phil's a gamer. He just played Stalker 2. Let's hear about it.
Yeah, you know, Stalker, if you played the first game, has kind of a unique setting and story, and it's really nice to see what they've done in this build of continuing the lore of what Stalker is about, what your role is in the world, and kind of how the world invites you into what your role is and your kind of task. I'm trying to do this without kind of spoiling too much.
Don't spoil it, Phil.
You can spoil if you want.
No,
you're
no, that's their
yourself.
Game. Like, I don't want to do that.
Don't spoil.
But
you play.
I'll also say, you know, they're a dev that spends a lot of time perfecting the game in terms of the technology. I think they're still on that track.
Yeah.
Like, they're still obviously the game's not done. So it's, but yeah, I just love that they've done a good job moving the Stalker kind of world forward, but being very tried and true to what Stalker's about.
Yeah.
Wow. Swagbag says this man is lying. Well, find this. He almost spoiled Stalker 2. He knows so, you heard all about it. But you know what? Why don't we get the tapes and watch and play Stalker 2? Want to see? Oh, man. You're going to want to see this. Phil, show us how you played Stalker 2, Phil. He talked about it so much. They worked so hard in the game. Grinders, get ready. Steven, get ready. Here's Phil's hands-on at Gamescom with Stalker 2. Tell me how he came up with all this and this.
Yeah, right here.
Tell Sonic, give all it back. I'll leave a mark. Ah, velocity. Tramp stamp is just the start.
Oh, they're very angry. Sorry, that's okay. That's okay.
That's it. That's it. He's done. Booty bomb. That was his hands-on with Stalker 2 at Gamescom. Phil. There's him playing Stalker 2. He shoots the guy. He's not even aiming. And he dies. He's like, oh, I'm done. Ready for Game Pass. I'm out. Thanks, Phil. He's wearing the same jacket. And he got on this show. Phil, tell me about that Stalker 2.
Trying to do this without kind of spoiling too much.
Don't spoil
it. One of the things in chat, and many of the fans really appreciate about you, is how much you love to play the games themselves. So I know just over here, we can't see behind me, we've got the Stalker 2 demo.
Yeah.
And you've taken that for a spin as well. It's been 16 years since the original, so can you tell us what stood out to you?
Yeah, you know, Stalker, if you played the first game, has kind of a unique setting and story, and it's really nice to see what they've done in this build of continuing the lore of what Stalker is about, what your role is in the world, and kind of how the world invites you into what your role is and your kind of task. I'm trying to do this without kind of spoiling too much.
So, but, you can spoil if you want.
No, that's their game. Like, I don't want to do that. But I'll also say, they're a dev that spends a lot of time perfecting the game in terms of the technology. I think they're still on that track.
Yeah.
Like, they're still, obviously the game's not done. I just love that they've done a good job moving the Stalker kind of world forward, but being very tried and true to what Stalker's about.
Yeah, for sure. And
he looked like he was done playing the game after just shooting at one guy and he died, and he's like, yeah, that's out. I'm done. Grinded. If that's the biggest load of Phil Ness right there, that was him playing that game. He walked away from it. It wasn't like he died and he's like, oh, I need to try this again. He leaned in. Yo, he put his hands. Look. He even asked Todd Howard if he wants to play, and Todd Howard's like, no thanks.
Yeah.
Don't mind the end of the booty bomb. That was the one of the Grindhouse songs. I just use this clip.
Still, son, give my word back. I'll leave a mark. Velocity. Tramp stamp is just the start.
Booty bomb. Booty bomb.
Oh, they're very angry.
Sorry. That's okay.
That's okay. He plays his love. That's it. He says, perfect game pass. Perfect. But you see how much he's talking about it. Same jacket.
To be totally honest, even under the best circumstances in games development.
You know, really continues to go through.
Is Uber driver, Todd Howard.
I see, and they've talked about this when I've talked to them, that building the game has kind of been a rep forward, even.
I hope he played more of it, because there is him playing that game, and he walked away from it.
Here, and you're just hey, what's the new hot console? Not video game console, but actually arcade console cabinet that you're going to go play. And I love that today those communities, Scrolls Online, which has a
grind this. What did I just see?
That's how I play video games, and I'm the old guy, but like that's the only way I could play that in Pong at my home, at my house. That's how I play video games, and there was a community in the arcade of like, hey, what's the new hot console? Not video game console, but actually arcade console cabinet that you're going to go play. And I love that today those communities, they're still physical. Like you asked, why are we here at Gamescom? We have a fan fest tonight. It's going to be awesome with the local community. And I love that today those communities, they're still physical. Like you asked, why are we here at Gamescom? Because we have a fan fest tonight.
Indeed,
it's
going
to be awesome with the local community and the people that are here, but also the virtual communities.
Oh,
and I think it's
no.
one of the unique things in video games.
Why that did
video
that
games can connect people across geographies.
Why is he tramp stamping everybody?
Races, religions. Like, it is just a connector of people.
Why is he tramp? Why
it's a
is
game
fan?
Like a Sea of Thieves.
Why do they, when they say Fan Fest, goes right to the tramp stamps? Right to signing people. Watch, she's like, Fan Fest is tonight. They don't have any games for Fan Fest. Instead, they're tramp stamping everybody.
Community and gaming to me.
He's like Fan Fest, and they go to tramp stamps.
Link.
Like, yeah,
it's
100%.
From my early days of literally
this
going
to
the arcade. Mm-hmm. I'm the old guy.
Look what happens.
And I love that today those
Fan Fest. You don't play any games at Fan Fest.
Communities, they're still physical. Like you asked, why are we here at Gamescom? Because we have a Fan Fest tonight.
Indeed,
it's going to be awesome with the local community and the people that are here, but also the virtual communities. And I think it's one of the unique things in video games that video games can connect people across geographies, across races, religions. Like, it is just a connector of people. Mm-hmm. And when it's a game like a Sea of Thieves, like a Grounded, like a Flight Sim, so many of our games now have these Elder Scrolls.
Dude, they're still doing Sea of Thieves tattoos last year. That's it. That's it, Grinders. We got about 200 people in here at a late night Grindhouse. I'm grinding. That's it. I'm going into song. I'm going into song. Tramp stamps. We can find the cheat code. I can't take it. Hit that like button.
It's like they hit explode. The console's lagging. The graphics pixelated.
Oh, God.
We're losing every match. Our teammates frustrated.
Phil Ness. Sign here, please. Not like this, Phil. Not like this. More tramp stamps.
Xbox tramp stamps, they're here to stay. Join the party, come on, it's Matt Boutte.
There you go, Grinders. That's what the VIPs have been jamming about. Xbox, sign here, please. I had to break it to song with that one. But those are the Gaming Grindhouse hits here at the Gaming Grindhouse. You get those with Grinds Pass Day 1 songs. There's plenty of coming to your way, and also many that released for the members there. But please, Xbox, sign here. I had to break into song. He talking more. Every time they see FanFest, they got the tattoos out. Stop stamping people and play some friggin' games. Thank you, Ryan. Make it more entertaining than Xbox. Exactly. We got to make this entertaining. We got to figure out. There's got to be some spin. Because this is some boring ass shit. They're talking FanFest, and you think Phil shows people playing games? No, he shows people getting tramp stamped. Ship it. You want shipped? I don't know. We got to ask the VI. We got to ask the members, the Grinders. They gotta vote on them to see which ones get unreleased, so you can listen to it anytime you want and have the video on that one. But that's one of the perks of being a Grinder, a VIP. So if you get those VIPs, hey, feel free to upgrade and do that. But man, the music's good. That's what I say, man. Good jams. And I'm gonna try to get them on Spotify to try to do that, because I have a playlist, so you have them on the playlist. So you can just listen to them. That's the next thing. But yeah, there it goes again. But I had to break into song with that one, Grinders. It's a late night.
Online, which has a big...
See if these tattoos. Phil, see if these came out 2017. And what's crazy, Grinders, all this, all the green behind Phil Ness, all this, and guess what? They had secretly ninjas working behind the frosted glass rooms making PlayStation 5 versions. This guy sitting right here with the eye patch, loving the brand of Sea of Thieves, getting stamped and mocked by Phil Ness. What he's not going to know is in another 6 months, this game is going to PlayStation, and he could have just bought a PS5. Anyway. Anyway. The front, they make you think, Xbox, we love you, we love you. The frosted glass people are making the game for PlayStation and making them play better, too, and using the DualSense. Phil got you getting tramp stamped of games and he's shipping to PlayStation. Holy crap. Hopefully they're not permanent. The guy's like, I love Xbox for Sea of Thieves. Oh, shit. Phil's like, you know what? We're putting it on PlayStation now and it works better. It's playing better graphics.
Scrolls Online, which has a big over there, has a big presence on our show floor.
Wait, what is that other tattoo that guy has? What is this one? And they're tramp stamping the shit out of that guy. Yeah, that guy, he had something
in the characters and the lore big over there.
What the hell is this? Is that a mole? What the hell is that thing? I gotta go back. More fan fest.
And when it's a game like a Sea of Thieves, like a Grounded, like a Flight Sim, so many.
Oh no! Oh no! He actually used those games as an example, Phil. No.
Like you asked, why are we here?
This lady, look at this. She got the Kraken on her arm, but in the game, you don't even see the body of the Kraken. Per Next Gen 720, shout out to him, the Kraken's still lacking. Even on PlayStation 2. Son of a bitch. He only has 5 sea dicks. He don't have a body, so what is she drawing on her arm? The Kraken don't have a body in Sea of Thieves. This lady, you should know. She should be like, excuse me, I just need the tentacles, because that's the representation of the Kraken in the game. He don't have a body. There's no body to the Kraken. Still to this day. All the updates, they never put a body on the Kraken. It gave you shocks.
Gamescom, because we have a fan fest tonight.
Indeed.
It's going to be awesome with the local.
Kraken is still lacking.
Cool community and the people that are here, but also the virtual communities. And I think it's one of the unique things in video games, that video games can connect people across geographies, across races, religions. Like, it is just a connector of people. Mm-hmm. And when it's a game like a
connector of people, and look at the games that he uses.
Sea of Thieves, like a Grounded, like a Flight Sim. So many.
Are those the three games? Is Flight Sim the next one going to PlayStation?
Our games now have these Elder Scrolls Online, which has a big over there, has a big presence on our show floor.
And they've got a really nice table in there as well.
They do that big round table.
A really nice table. It's another one of the things.
Community around. Feelings about the empire. When free-to-play came to console, it'll be the end of the console if free-to-play comes to console. Some people think it is, but like, you know, clearly the console's still there and free-to-play happened. ID at Xbox. Well, we have went virtual for a while, but now we're here back, and there's so many.
Is Phil going to hype up consoles grinders? Is he going to do this?
Fans and players here. It's like just such a special time.
And it's special for Xbox as well. As we've mentioned a few times on the show already, that it's the 10th anniversary of ID at Xbox.
I have my ID at Xbox.
There it is. Right there. He's sporting it. He knew what he was doing. I'd love for you to reflect on any.
Remember that game from ID at Xbox that just said we're not coming to Xbox? Oh, damn.
Memories or moments you have from the introduction of ID and how it's gone over the past 10 years?
I'm going to start with a couple things.
Yeah.
One, we always have discussions internally when new things are going to happen on the console. And there's always some different kind of feelings about the input. When free-to-play came to console, it'll be the end of the console if free-to-play comes to console. Some people think it is. But, like, you know, clearly the console's still there and free-to-play happened. ID at Xbox. Well, when we have unmanaged partners that are building games on Xbox, what does that mean for a console? Because we started with this silly thing where publishers had 2 slots of arcade games that they could go do. It was like a silly policy in Xbox. Opening it up and allowing anybody who submits and actually has good intent to build a game on the platform has led to some of the best games that have. People forget, like, that Fortnite actually came through ID at Xbox. When you ask about, like, some of the special moments, I have to go to games from places where we'd never seen games for Xbox. I remember going to the Brazil game show and meeting new. Sometimes you're playing with your family and what can I do? Sometimes I'm Xbox players, or like flying over here, I'm playing on my
here he goes sometimes again.
It's just me time, and I want to go
unmanaged.
Do things. And how many players show up? We look at our monthly active players, our daily active players. And when I say on Xbox there, whether you're playing on the cloud and you're streaming to a device that we don't know anything about, whether you're playing on a PC, and as Microsoft, we know something about the PC, or you're playing on one of our consoles. Uh-huh. Like, those are all Xbox players. Or
whoa, did he just say one of our consoles? Look at the fellow with the face. Did he say one of our consoles? So he didn't consider Sony and PlayStation and Xbox. Oh, yeah. He got a Brazilian wax.
Like, those are all Xbox players. Or, like, flying over here, I'm playing on my ROG Ally, streaming to a device that we don't know anything about, whether you're playing on a PC, and as Microsoft, we know something about the PC, or you're playing on one of our consoles. Uh-huh. Like, those are all Xbox players. Or, like, flying over here, I'm playing on my ROG Ally on the airplane, and I think about that as my Xbox away from home, or my Steam Deck. Like, I want those things to feel as connected and as complete as an Xbox experience as any piece of hardware that we build. We will continue to focus on hardware. It's an important part of our team and what we can go do. But I don't want our hardware to be a limitation on who can actually feel like they're part of the Xbox community. Mm-hmm. If you buy hardware from us, we're gonna do an awesome job supporting you. We wanna make sure great games are there. If you have the device that you wanna bring and be part of Xbox, we also want that to be 100% great on Xbox. And it's, as you said, it's putting the player's decision on where they want to play at the center of it.
And it's just there for them, whichever one they want to grab
right.
at that time.
And not only is it there, my save game moves with me, mm-hmm. my community is there, so I can make progress on any platform I want to play on, and I can grind my characters, I can make my way through the story anywhere I've been. It's one of the best things about Starfield, pointing at it.
That's over there.
Yeah, I've been moving. I play on work, on my PC. When I go home, I sit on my console and I go play. And it's just a continuous experience for me, and everything moves. It's fantastic.
Amazing.
So then why was Booty making a big deal about it when he's had that sad podcast, that Xbox podcast where, why was Booty, if Phil says it's great, it's working, it works great, then why was Booty making a big deal about
that? I think we at First Party can come back to sort of some core principles. First, that all of our games will be on the available frame of Xbox, which is play with your friends where they are, play on the devices you want, play the games you want. So that is really only possible at a practical level when you know that your saves and your player are going to be able to move across all those parts. So not all of our games today are necessarily built to take advantage of that. There still will be some games that don't. As we bring more teams into the Xbox family, there's some catch up to do as we get there. But that cross-play, cross-save is like so fundamental to what we're doing. And I think it's something that we as First Party get such a good benefit from being so close to the platform.
Yeah, absolutely.
Phil, it sounded great. Phil was like, yo, it just works. It's great. I'm doing it. Booty coming out there like he's inventing the wheel there. It's like, oh, there's something we really got to focus on. Not everything has it. Guys. What are we doing here? The change, the shift. How? What about those paid demos, Ryan? Remember that? Project Warcraft? I don't know. It's been over a year. We haven't seen one. They were supposed to pay devs to make demos to get an assessment if they want to be in Game Pass. That hasn't happened. It sound perfect. When he's sitting here with the Xbox booth behind him, sounds great. Sounds like everything is fine and dandy. And what the hell happened from Gamescom in September till now? And it comes back to what I was saying before in our Monday show. Something happened between last year and now.
Starfield, Forza, and I think Starfield. He was very, going into this, I believe that he thought Starfield was going to be that savior. Starfield was going to be that turning point, that proof that, hey, it finally came together, it works. And Starfield failed to impress. Yeah, Starfield did not do what it needed to do. And I've always said that. People will be like, well, Starfield's not a bad game. It's fine. I like it. I'm not saying it's bad. I'm not saying that you shouldn't like it. I'm not saying that it didn't get decent reviews. What I'm saying was that that game, too much of, and we knew this going into Starfield, that Starfield was riding all the pivots and twists and turns and pressure, the lack of Xbox games of quality of being built, the fallout of Halo, the disasters of Crackdown, and just all these games that came out with promises and failed to impress, and coming off the heels of the worst in Redfall, a game that they announced, a lot was riding on Starfield. Starfield was to bring the burden of all those mishaps. Unfairly, I might add, that Starfield did that. And I think taking it off of PlayStation and making it more of just an Xbox exclusive, I think hurt it even more. I really think so, because it put even more pressure on it. I think if it was a multi-platform game, I think Starfield maybe wouldn't have had so many eyeballs on it. But as soon as they made Starfield exclusive, and I'm not saying, oh, if they put it on PlayStation, it would have done better. No. What I'm saying is the perception of, by making it an exclusive game to your platform, put even more pressure on Starfield to deliver on what it needed to do. Jack up sales. Sell crazy. Jack up the Game Pass. Move consoles. Move hardware. Do everything. Show that the purchase of Bethesda and ZeniMax was the best deal in gaming and brought great games to the platform. All those things. And as soon as you made it exclusive, that pressure times tenfold, because now everything that Xbox did was riding on it because you made it exclusive. I think if it made multiplat, it would still have that pressure, but not as much. But because of that, I think it just got another boatload of pressure put on it. And it didn't do what it needed to do. And you see it. You see it. You see it in the videos. You see it in the updates. Even I was watching a video earlier today, and Maddie Plays going over about Starfield and about where the updates, where's the new DLC, where are the content updates of new features and new things. All it is just fixes and tweaks. He said it reminded him of Cyberpunk in the sense that they're just fixing the game. Shadows, load screens, maps for the cities, glitches and missions and just bug fixes and stuff. We're over 6 months into that game's release. You're still doing that stuff? It's just a laundry list of just like, missions won't load, this won't do, head turns, NPC not there. Opening a door while scanning. Yeah, well, that's right, Ron M. Making it exclusive caused it not to even break even, yeah. And there was no excuse. There was no excuse, Josh, I know. But they made a big deal about it. But they were hoping up Starfield, and then they put all the pressure on it. Like I said, just like that Halo criticism, they made the bed. They overpromised and underdelivered. That's their motto. That's what Microsoft Xbox has done. They have had Phil at the helm, has overpromised and underdelivered. From day one, Scalebound, I'll make up for it. Street Fighter, I'll make up for it. Never did. Never even gave you more Killer Instinct. Nothing. I canceled Fable. We'll make up for it. We'll get it. Nothing. The most powerful console in the world. What is the game to show the power? Nothing. They did nothing. They talked all that hype, all that power, and no games launched with that console. He's talking here, my save works. It does that. It works. then why is Booty coming out there going, well, it's not in all our games. It's a fundamental thing we got to fix. Phil says PC is a platform that he respects. Meanwhile, his Xbox App Store is the worst. And he's like, we got to do better. That's all he says. No, Josh, Halo still does not have assassinations. It still doesn't even have the classic shotgun in it. We're sorry. Copyright. Exactly. You can't fumble this much and then have Starfield come out exclusive and think that it's going to fix everything. It wasn't. And you're sitting here now at the cusp of, we care about hardware. We're going to do this. And you think a handheld Xbox is going to magically fix all this? You think Hellblade 2 is going to fix it? You should be riding the... First off, what I don't even understand is Hellblade 2 looks good, right? It actually looks like a graphical showpiece. Why aren't you embracing that to reinforce the power of the Xbox? Why aren't you using... You finally have the game that was announced when you named it the Series X in Hellblade 2, and you have kept quiet and only showed it in January, not even showing the combat, the breakdown, anything. I know it may be short, but my goodness, you should be showing that game at every ounce by, you know, Series X, Hellblade 2. Series X, Hellblade 2. Shift the market. Shift the perception of booster existing. Try to use Hellblade 2 as a way to move the Series X. And the fact that they're not doing that shows that they don't care. Same thing. Starfield was supposed to be that game and they didn't even bundle it with the console. They don't care. And when they don't care, the customer's not going to care. And when the customer doesn't care, then nobody cares what you're doing. And I don't know who you're trying to win. I don't know who you're trying to get. I don't know who you're trying to grow. But you're not doing your part at all. You are not doing your job as part of the gaming industry to help it grow. All you're doing is hurting the industry because you aren't delivering and doing your job. You're not doing your part in making great games and moving stuff. You're not doing it. Instead, you just talk and talk and talk. And now you're leeching on to the success of PlayStation and Switch to try to move some games. And what is that going to do? That's not going to save you either. The only thing that saves you is great games. The one thing that you said that you don't want to do because it's not going to change anything. And you answered everybody's question right there and then, where you said making great games is not going to do anything. And now, you lost your eye on the prize. You always did. That Xbox tax. There's no Xbox tax. The taxes, the issues are what they make. They made all these issues. They made the perception of Halo to be what it is. They showed it off. They talked about power and worlds and Slipspace Engine and didn't do anything of it. They talked about the power of the console. Didn't have a launch lineup. They talked about all the studios they have. Where are the games? They talked about the console's the most powerful thing. Go get a console. Get a console. We're not going to lose this gen. And now they're like, consoles are not doing anything. Well, you're not doing anything. I don't know, Anthony. I think Hellblade is going to do decent reviews. But if I was them, man, I would be using that game right now as the first graphical showpiece. At least you could just show it off and just show it with an X. That's it. But the fact that we are now in April, the game supposedly comes out in another month. Man, they're going to get smothered in news. They're already like games behind already this year. They're already irrelevant. Considering the biggest stuff has come out already. It's like Final Fantasy. It's Final Fantasy, Helldivers. Now Soul Blade's going to take the world by storm again in a few weeks. And what are you going to do? Oh, now we're going to talk about Hellblade 2? It's like, come on. And then if Sony does a show? And what about all your other games? What about Avowed? What about Avowed? What about Fable that you showed last year? But the games, Indiana Jones, when's that coming out? You just put a year on that. Indiana Jones. Avowed. Which, well, that looks bad too. That's what I said. Hellblade 2 at least looks something. Oh, shit. Ryan says Hellblade's behind the frosted glass. Uh-oh. That's maybe why they're not showing it. They're working on the PlayStation version. Oh, my goodness. But, yeah. Just to recap, like, it's just crazy watching these videos, knowing what we know now and knowing what has happened and just seeing how they hyped up things that never came to be. They talked about games being something that they never were. And the Elder DLC, and I know, it's going to be, yeah, Fable. Who knows? He was saying that was gameplay. He already put his foot in the mouth. Let's see when the game actually shows and people are playing it. Let's see if that Fable stuff was gameplay. Everwild. I'm not even talking about those games. Perfect Dark and More Perfect Help. I'm not even talking about those games. I'm talking about the games that they showed at that in the Developer Direct with no dates. Indiana Jones. Janky third person to first person moves. Yeah, we'll see how that works. Wolfenstein with a skin. I don't know. But where's that release date? Where's Avowed's release date? I don't know, man. It should be Indiana Jones. Yeah, that's right, Mr. Grimm. It should be. But going back to the first and third person, it's going to be whack. They're in deep trouble. We don't know what these games are going to look like. And the more Phil talks about big budget games and games costing money and him making money, you think the first thing Phil wants to do is take a game that's been in development for 6 years or 5 years, good AAA or whatever, like a Fable or whatever, and throw it in Game Pass that's not growing? Like, do you think that's the solution to what he's doing? Like, you think he can't wait? He's going to milk the hell out of this, and hopefully you forget about it. You really think this guy wants to stay there? Go, yeah, you know what? All right. Let's throw more money into Fable, and let's put that in Game Pass. That's not growing. I wouldn't be surprised if they changed the tiers of Game Pass in preparation for those games. Because I can't see him talking about now. He's saying it's a business, and Xbox has to. That's all he was talking about in that article, which I'll do that article. We'll go over to Phil Save the Industry, but the whole thing about it's a business. The one I talked about on Monday, it's a business. Xbox is a business. I got to make sure it's alive in the future. All that stuff that he said was all. That doesn't really jive. But let's make a very expensive game and put it in Game Pass. As close to AAA as we can get. Exactly. What compromises were made with those games? Or what compromises are being made? Are they making the PlayStation versions? Are they trying to do something to compensate for that? Well, guys, we'll put it in Game Pass, but we got to sell it somewhere else. You know, we got to sell it on PlayStation at least to make some money back because the people on Xbox aren't buying it. They're waiting for it in Game Pass. That's our promise. So we'll put it in Game Pass, but we'll sell it on PlayStation because we got to sell it. Because taking a game that we spent years making for AAA or whatever the hell we made for it, we're not going to make that money back by just dumping it into Game Pass and nobody buying it. So who knows what pivots are going on. But he mentioned a lot about business. Business, business, business. And you know, if you ask me about business, the first thing I'm not doing is putting a game that we spent so much money on and saying it's going to Game Pass for free or for a service that's not growing. Himself saying it's not growing. It's stagnant. The consoles are not growing. So you got to do something. But all of a sudden now, it's right, emergency CPR. All of a sudden, it's the Xbox business that has to stay. I don't know, man. But we'll see. But I want to thank everybody for coming through, man. We have 200 people here. Late night grindhouse. Haven't done one in a while. It's incredible. You guys are up all over the globe. But hit that like button. Share it out. New tunes coming your way. VIPs. Ultimate Grinders, new tune coming your way. You get day one drop. So if you got a VIP, feel free to upgrade. You get access to all the songs that are being used on the Gaming Grindhouse, and you can listen to them at your heart's content with the videos and everything. So if you want to upgrade, do that. If you got a VIP tonight, or if you're a VIP, you can upgrade to that. And then, you know, shout out to everybody. Thank you again for all the super chats and new members. Welcome. Still learning. Hit that like button. More content coming your way at the Gaming Grindhouse. And with that, we'll end it with the Phil Ness of Game Pass song. End it. Good night, everybody. Hit that like button. Share it out. Thanks again. Appreciate everybody coming through. Talk to you guys later.
Oh, and Psychonauts 2. New games are coming fast. 12 minutes in Hades. And they're all on Game Pass. Somerville, a Plague Tale Requiem. What to play first?